Ένα. Hello everyone, welcome to the stream. We will start in a couple of minutes and hope you like this new stream and you have a good time. See you in a second. It seems we are alive. Hello everyone. I'm George. I would like to welcome you to one more stream. After the last week stream that we had with Ignacio Gulli, I received a lot of messages from a lot of you with positive comments, and you asked me for new streams about AmigaOS, and this was something that I was thinking for a long time, and here we are. We can start from today. I will start to do every Friday this time a stream about AmigaOS, AmigaOS 3.2, and we will see various things about it and applications that we can use for everyday usage. And we will see for the future what it will bring. I don't want to be something like a monologue from my side. And I would like to ask you to help me and request things. And if you want something to be presented, or if you want something to see together here, that will be great if you can give me this feedback. That's why I prefer to do Twitch streams than create YouTube videos. That is one way communication. I believe that Twitch is better when people talk and exchange ideas and propose things. So this stream is somehow you can change it, and you can say what exactly you would like to see. So for today, I would like to see with you the next steps after we installed AmigaOS 3.2. Actually, today I received my copy of the CD, and this weekend will be dedicated to install the ROMs for my Amiga 1200, and install again the AmigaOS 3.2 on that machine. So for today, I would like to see with you a few applications that we could install for the that will be the next steps after the first installation of AmigaOS 3.2. And we have the same emulated environment that we had the previous week. I didn't change anything there, so we can see all the steps all together. Welcome, Amiga Gamer 1200. Nice to see you. Welcome, SLD Snake. And Perceda Lemon Amiga, welcome. My roadshow just arrived. Yeah, roadshow is it's an awesome HTTP stack. That's what I am using, and we can see together today how people can install stuff from AmigaOS 3.9, and if someone wants to use the how it was called, the application, the HTTP stack that was coming from it from with AmigaOS 3.9, we will see it. Please tell me how it was called, because I forget it. Welcome, NPagonis 73. Welcome, RetroPassion UK. RetroPassion, you had a tough week, right? With delivering all these orders. So for starting, I would like to show you that. Yes, we have the FSUI. I'm still using FSUI because I'm on a Linux machine. That's my operating system of choice for daily usage and for my work. And I always use FSUI. I don't know if you guys are using something different. For example, the WinUI is much better, but for my needs, FSUI is fine. It doesn't have any issues. I'm waiting the hype for my OS 3.2, says SLD Snake. Yeah, there's a lot of hype there. That's why I wanted to see with you guys the first steps after the installation, because I believe that we can see a few tools that are pretty nice, and how we can bring things to make the AmigaOS 3.2 even better and complete. Retro Passion UK says, lol, yes, very busy. Problem, we are getting them out. You're welcome, Retro Passion. For it was my pleasure to do these videos, and actually it was a good chance for me to start these streams. Amiga Gamer 1200 says, I use FS UI because I'm usually on Linux. I love I can port my configs between desktop and a Raspberry Pi. Yeah, you are completely right. And you know that for my Amiga 1200, I usually get this SD memory card from the machine. I mount it on Linux and get an image on that, and then I mount that image exactly in the FS UI, and I have all the partitions there. If I want to do massive work on these partitions, it's pretty fast, and especially if you have to install a lot of WSD load that you want to test, it's extremely fast, and then I burn that image back to the SD card, and I use it on my Amiga just like that. And it's a good way to get also a backup of your SD card in case something happens, because it gets all the SD in one file, in one image, and you have all the partitions, everything is there. Twilight Zoner, welcome, looking forward to it as well. You mean for the AmigaOS 3.2, right? As I told you on my previous stream, it is far the best AmigaOS 3 that is released, in my opinion, of course. I haven't tried mounting my CF card, only on WinUI with disable HD safety check flag. Oh, okay, says Amiga Gamer 1200. I just prepared my SD box mount list using FFS. Nice. Twilight Zoner, you ordered from Amiga on the Lake with the ROMs, or only the CD-ROM? Although it's not needed, the file system change. SLD Snakes says that. Okay. The CD, yeah. Twilight Zoner, you mean, what kind of Amiga are you going to install it and use it? Let me show you here that 1200, okay. A lot of people here with 1200s, right? Let me do a small poll. How many of you have a 1200? I believe, in my opinion, I find a lot of people having 1200, and don't hate me about what I'm going to say. They have 1200 and 500s, for example, or a 600, but the most used machine, in my experience, is the 1200 from most people. Nice. So, from the last stream, we have the, I believe you see that, we have the 1200, the emulator 1200 with 3.1 ROM, 68020 CPU, and we have also JIT compiler enabled, and that's it. Maybe later we can enable BSD socket so we can see some internet access from that. Yeah, Mr. Bytes 9667 says 1200s besides 500s, 2000 and 3000. Mr. Bytes, are you going to install 3.2 on all of them? Are they? Are you using all of them? One of the first things that you might want to do is to install LHA, the command LHA or unzip, so that you can de-archive files that you can download from Aminet and things like that. So on my on my machine, I have a separate hard disk, let's say, that I called it Essentials, and I have some software here that I downloaded so we can see today. Mr. Byte says probably yes, but for now, first the 1200, right? Right. SLD Snake says also 500 is a very widespread, I think. Yeah, it is. It is. But for productivity, maybe people are using mostly 1200. Now, you might ask what kind of productivity. I believe that the one of the things that it has 2 megabytes of cheap RAM is a huge benefit, and with a card of 8 megabytes, you can have a pretty good Amiga with a low cost. But I might be wrong. Amiga Gamer 1200 says, I'm hoping Gulliver will update his best workbench packs. A nice way to get LHA and all the other small tools compressors. Actually, Amiga Gamer, we are going to see how you can get the things that you need from this package. I believe that he is going to work on that and give us something like a new package of best workbench. But I prefer on my machine to choose exactly what I need from various sources and use exactly that and not install everything. Although Best Workbench was, and it is a very good package. And that's what I'm going to use actually right now. I have here a Best Workbench. No, you can't see that. You can't see that. Here it is, right. Good. Sigurborn L, good afternoon. Welcome to the stream. Today we are going to see, and thank you for the hosting. Today we are going to see the next steps after the first installation of AmigaOS 3.2. So we are going to see the first tools or commands that we need to install to do some things, and some of applications or utilities that you might like to use, how to install them, and etc. Mr. Bytes 1967 says, been back since the late 90s, so still searching for parts for some of my Amigas. Yeah, I can feel you. Interesting times, I will say, because you have so many things to learn about and see a lot of new stuff that is pretty interesting. So, as I said before, we have a partition here called Essentials, where I have some applications, utilities, and also I have the best workbench 1.3 package, all the ADFs. I would like to remind you that the AmigaOS 3.2 has an internal way to manage the ADF files. So what I need to do is just double click a file and it is mounted on the desktop. And here we have the first disk. I will not do any installation manually, automatically, like using the installer. Sigurborn says that he's in the process of repairing his A40 hardened. Oh, nice machine. And trying to puzzle together a new 500. The only stable Amiga I have now is the Revision 3 1.2 based 500, but the Mister does work. Yeah. I never had a 4000 Amiga. Never. And I'm looking for one, but the prices are pretty high. So I will wait until they fall down as much as possible. SLD Snake, yes, I agree. There is a new version of Visual Preferences. We will see that. with OS 3.2 fix and also eject ADF. Exactly. We are going to see both of them. So I mounted the first disk from Best Workbench, and let me see the files. You see that I'm changing the view of the windows because I'm using the shortcuts for the keyboard. If you would like me to show you exactly what I'm using, please tell me. I don't have an overview camera. Maybe in the future I'm going to buy one and put it there so you can see what I'm doing on the keyboard. But all the shortcuts are here. You can see them, show all files. For example, write Amiga and plus, and view by name, write Amiga and two. So you can use this, but I feel that using the shortcuts is much faster. Bowman says, sorry for being late. No worries, Bowman. We are happy that we have you here. Welcome. We see today a few things about the first steps after the first installation of AmigaOS 3.2. So we are going to see how to install a few tools, a few commands that are necessary for the first start. And for now, we are going to see how we can install LHA and unzip using the packages from Best Workbench, from Gulliver, from Ignacio, and we are going to see how we can do that inside the AmigaOS 3.2. We have the system exactly as we left it the last week from the last stream last Saturday. Bowman knows how things are working. Yeah, totally. So I mounted the Best Workbench one disk, and here we see the unzip, which is necessary. And I'm going to open a new shell here. So you see, when I had the window enabled and I ran the new shell from the execute command, automatically set me inside that folder. So if I do here a dir, I see exactly the same files. And unzip is one of the commands that is necessary for us. So I'm going to copy that to C, so we can use it later. And if I think that for now, best this disk is not necessary for us, but I'm going to keep it mounted. And then I'm going to mount Best Workbench, the second disk, which inside there is a zip file. So what I'm going to do is unzip this file. Perseta says, I think you use new shells so often you shall have an icon for it in your desktop. Maybe. Maybe. But I prefer the way that I'm doing through the execute, or it is good to add it here, or on tools, or on a separate menu item that you might want to use. And that's if you watched my previous stream, that's easy to be made, and we can see it if you want how we can do that using Rx and use the command, the necessary commands to do it, and you can have it added there on every boot. Yeah, I wanted to show you this, Amiga Gamer. You're right. Drag and drop to the CLI. So I dropped the 2.zip from a separated disk, and voila. So we are going to unzip this file to RAM. If I remember right, you have to use the argument -d, and yeah, it unzips all the files. So we have here LHA, LZX, and so many other things, but we need only the first one, so I'm going to cancel it. And here we have the C. So as soon as Gulliver is going to implement a new best workbench for the 3.2, for the AmigaOS 3.2, that's a good way to have it on your system. And also you might want to add other things from this package manually. So that's how you can do it. So LHA, LZX, copy to C. So now if I do something like LHA, no. If I do something like this, we have LHA on our machine. Nice. Yeah, drag and drop. To be honest with you, guys, I'm coming from AmigaOS 4. This is the AmigaOS of my choice, and that's there for a long time. And I was pretty happy when I saw that added on AmigaOS 3.2. It's when you start using it, it's very fast and very useful. It is new in the default console, but yeah, King On or Vincent may have had it for a while. Yeah. Actually, I was thinking to install Vincent here, the latest version. That's why I have this package over here. So what would you say, guys? Are you using it? Would you prefer this from the default one? And also I found this package said that it's needed to use Vincent on boot. So we can see how we can use it. For the first thing, I would like to test the title bar I see. So I'm going to do something like LHA, this one, into RAM. Come on, into RAM. Forgot the X, the argument. No. Wrong number of arguments in lay. Oh, that's a different LHA. What's that? Clip unit, screen, pop screen. It's not the usual LHA. Do you have any idea how I can use it? Please tell me. Because it doesn't seem to have the standard parameters here. Anyone? Any help? Benny Boy 80 says, I tend to use the directory Opus 4.17 for doing most things. Yeah, it's pretty useful. I chose to not show that here because everybody knows directory Opus. Okay. It is the default utility that you can use, and everyone uses that. Do you prefer the Magellan version of Directory Opus over the older version, the 4? For me, I always use the Directory Opus 4, but a lot of people are using the Magellan, the Directory Opus 5. So what's your opinion? Used an LH command for many years. Usually the LHA has an argument X, but this is a totally different version, I think. Hmm. Okay. File. Okay. Okay. So what we are going to do? File. No. We are going to give it the file that it needs, which is this one here. And we are going requester, bookmark, font name, font size, backdrop, window, port name. Okay. Clip unit, window. Some archivers use E instead of FEX for extract. This is a totally different LHA. It is the first time I see that here. Back in the days, I always used Directory Opus 4 too. Even nowadays, I tried Directory Opus 5 last year on Amithlon, and well, I liked it a little. Okay. Try running it with arguments. Without arguments. Just LHA, right? No. Nothing. Yeah, it seems like it opens requester. Should we... weird thing that LHA... Yeah, it's totally weird. Let me check if I can find the LHA from the Aminet and download this one. LHA command underscore. Yes. 2.15. It's the same version. Okay, let's download this one. Sorry for this delay. Save. Great. Let me go to the folder here. Okay. And see if something window update here. Okay. Give me a second, guys. Yeah. Great. Update. And we have here this one. So I'm going to do copy this one to C as LHA. Okay, LHA, yeah, that's the one that we all know and love and like to use, I guess. So what I wanted to do is LHA X, the, where is it, title bar, to RAM. Exactly. Sorry for this delay. So we are going to open the RAM disk, and we have here the title bar, and let's see what it says. I always read the documentation because the developer always has something interesting to tell us. and we have to understand how this tool is working before we add it on our machine. If you are a new user, you shouldn't really need to worry about this archive, okay? You encounter one that doesn't, you can simply copy the file. Okay. So if I go and double click on install, title bar image. Okay. Nice. I think that the include files and the library.fd file is necessary if you have the NDK installed and you want to develop using this class on any of your applications. This is necessary to install, and the documentation probably it has information about this class and how this can be used when you program with it. Great. Nice. So we are going to click on proceed. Proceed. Okay. Nice. The if I'm not wrong, the title bar image. Let's see the guide, and okay, it has information about the development of this. It's a shared library which, when opened, adds to the system a public boopsy image class called TBI class. This class implements several image types suitable for use in imagery of gadgets added to the title bar of a window, such as a conify image, a pop-up image, and things like that. Okay, so on. Also, a general purpose empty border only image is provided to be used as the background of more specialized title bar images. Okay. Hello, Aris Amiga. Thanks for joining the stream. We are looking today for various applications and utilities that we can add on AmigaOS 3.2 installation after the first installation. So hope you have a good time and in this stream. Amiga Gamer 1200 says that LHA's built-in help is called by LHAH. Extracts work with LHAE and LHAX. I prefer the X because I believe that it keeps the paths as it should, if I'm not wrong. LHAX. Let me see. Extract files with full path. Yeah. Extract file with E, it's extracting only the files. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if it messes all the files into one folder. We have our different preferences. I live in the shell when I use my Amiga. I use shell all the time. Yeah, you are right. I don't think it is anything for end users. Bowman, I thought that this would be able to add at least minimize gadget here on the windows of the system. Maybe I'm wrong. Yeah, probably you are right. We might not see anything here unless not before any application starts using it. I'm looking forward to install this on the Amiga 4000 when it gets fixed. I'm getting reasonably sure I can actually fix it. On your own single board, you are going to fix your Amiga. That's cool. The pleasure that you are going to get is doubled after that. Bowman, yeah, you might be right. Probably you are right and I'm wrong. Only when an application uses it, this title bar I see. I wanted to try that because I remember back in a lot of years ago, we had something similar on AmigaOS 4. If you wanted to have the minimize button, the minimize gadget on the windows of the system, you had to copy something like that in an IC file that used that added that gadget in the windows. So I thought to give it a try, but yeah, probably you are right. After that, we could install a Magic User Interface. I have two versions here, 3.8 and 5.0, an older version, not the latest one. But it will be fine. I think only if the, I think the thing you want is the new visual preference. We are going to install it and see if that adds that gadget. So what would you say? What would you prefer? Magic User Interface 3.8 or 5? On an emulated Amiga like this one, I would say that we could install 5.0, but what would you like to see? I need to burn yet another ROM though. Just finished burning 3.1.4. I see. Yeah, it will be better to burn 3.2 and use your Amiga because as we discussed on the previous stream, with that specific ROM, you are going to have less chip RAM used on boot. So I would say, yeah, go ahead and create that ROM. And that's why I ordered my ROMs for my 1200. It's very nice to have the 3.1.4 in the Amiga though, saves lots of rebooting. And you will have the same benefit with 3.2 as well. So do you agree to go with new 3.8? Or you prefer 5? What are you using on your machines? And half a meg of chip RAM. You mean that the machine has half a meg of chip RAM? Or that's how you save from the... by using the... ROM, the 3.2 ROM. So I'm going with 3.8 Magic User Interface since most of the people who are going to install AmigaOS 3.2, they are going to use it on a classic Amiga on a machine and not on emulation. So I would prefer to go with this time. 5 works fine, yeah. On real hardware. Yeah, and the developers are still maintaining this version, so it will be better to use the latest version, right? But on some things, Magic User Interface 5 is a little bit slower. Well, I had map ROM, so half a meg of RAM that was part of 128 megs of fast in the 4000. But yeah, lots of reboots, map ROM reboot, load module reboot. Yeah, totally. In these situations, when you can map ROM on your machine, it will be better to get the basic ROM and then add your create your own ROM on your hard disk with all the added modules and use this one to map ROM and boot with a single boot. Is there any use in installing warp data types or any other data types in 3.2, or the already installed ones are fine? It depends what you want to do with the data types. I believe that the already installed data types are supporting all the different types of the file types that are out there, so you won't have any problems with loading an image. But maybe, especially if you have a PowerPC, it will be better to use warp data types. But if you have a 68,000 CPU, you are going to be fine with the ones that come with AmigaOS 3.2, which definitely got updated on the latest version. Exactly, Bowman. Yeah. So with the Vampire, you won't have any issue why install the warp data types. I will see only in case some specific file or variation of a file type, it is not supported. And it is supported from the warp data types. Only in this case. So I'm going to install the Magic User Interface, so it is standard things. Everybody did something like that on their machine. So I'm going to install it in system partition. Please select, okay, drawer called MUI will be created here. Nice. Are there any utilities or applications that you would like to have on AmigaOS 3.2 and bring them from AmigaOS 3.9? Some people would like maybe have AmiDoc. What would you like to bring? Since we did the installation of Magic User Interface, let me install a couple of more things. For example, AmiSSL. And I'm doing that because it is going to ask for a reboot. So let's do that as well. So we are going to have one reboot only. I had little luck getting 3.1.4 to play nice with the Magic Workbench colors. If I'm not wrong, there is a... Let me see, Workbench. Set Magic Workbench colors here. And you see here, Sigurborn, everything works fine. The colors are fine. So you go, and I think this one exists on 3.1.4. If I'm not wrong, it exists there. Yeah, I think it is in 3.1.4, and you find it in workbench. Here it's a checkbox, set magic workbench colors. All tricks, eh? With how it is called, the one that locks the palette on specific palette and doesn't change. To be honest, I was never such a big fan of the Magic Workbench. I preferred the glow icons. That was my preference. Sorry about that. Okay, AmigaSSL doesn't fit in the RAM that we have. Let's do the reboot. Full palette, yeah. And actually, I think that I have, let me see here, I have an installation of 3.1. Let me start that and see if there is this checkbox, so to be sure. It is going to take 1 minute. Glow icons is great for RTG. Magic Workbench is good for non-RTG based machines. Yeah, but you're probably right on that. Yeah, you see, we are on AmigaOS 3.1.4, and there is that checkbox here, set magic workbench. So now you know how to do it. And the Mister, I use the Mister without RTG a lot of the time, although it has some basic support now. Oh, for RTG, eh? Mister is getting pretty good. And it has a low cost. So right now we have Magic User Interface installed here. Right? And it works pretty fine. Although that because we don't have the key, most of the choices here, the preferences are locked. We are fine to use it with applications that we need. And let's continue to install at least to install AmigaSSL, which is available free of charge, right? So I'm going to do LHAX AmigaSSL here. Will it work? Yeah. Okay, that's good to know. Easy way to solve it. Yeah, it is very easy. And very nice that the developers put it there. What I would like to add in my Workbench startup is, no, not that. Tools, commodities. Yeah, click to front. Let's see a little bit the tool types. Do not wait. And I don't want to use any qualifier. That's great. Double click. And now we have that. Click to front. That's good. Auto point. Nice. And you know that with F key, you can do things like if you set here something like, what do we have here? To cycle windows, we have Alt and Tab. No. Amiga tab. So we play with the OS until it finishes. Help, so guide. Let's see how we can set. So press Ctrl C to use the break command to exit F key when it is started from shell. Okay. Okay. But it doesn't show the how we can set the shortcuts in F key, how we can set the control with something else to do exactly what we need. For example, if we write Control 1, yeah. So if I go and write here Control W, but W, small W, because otherwise it needs, exactly, it needs the to press the shift if you have a capital W. So right now with Control W, I can rotate the windows. Okay. And all the shortcuts that you set in F key, they are saved in the configuration, and that's the tool types. What resolution monitor preferences are you using? I use WPAL high res no flicker in FSUI with 3.1. Actually, I'm using, let's see, the default screen modes high res list here with 256 colors. Good display and aspect for glow icons, but FSUI shows quite large borders. Ah, here, yeah. Yeah, it does. It does. In my opinion, if you want to have a good experience on an emulated Amiga, and because it is pretty easy to go and add RTG, you better go with that, because you can have full HD 1080p resolutions with thousands, millions of colors, so you can do that pretty easy. So the Amiga SSL was extracted. Let's update this folder and install it. AmigaOS 3, right? On sys, I will create a folder called Internet, just like the same way that it was done on AmigaOS 3.9, if you remember. And it says that the directory is going to be created that is named AmiSSL. So let's install it there. That's my CPU, that's fine. So to follow the same pattern. Would you like to add AmiSSL to your path? This will make it possible to execute OpenSSL tool without specifying full path to it. Yes, the AmiSSL assign needs to be added to user startup. So that, okay, proceed. And AmiSSL 4.9 installation finished. For those that don't know what exactly it did, it installed a folder here in internet where all the information, all the files and the certifications are installed, and the libraries, the necessary libraries here. Okay, and also if you open with the text edit the user startup, open, if we go here, user startup, no, that's wrong, user startup, there are those lines here that were added by the AmigaOS installer. Have in mind that Bowman says WPAL makes the borders big. Yeah. Have in mind that if you install Magic User Interface 5, you will see here in this area at the end a patch for the ASL requester that during the installer it asks if you want to for that to be installed. Sometimes people are confused and they say yes, install it, but afterwards they see that they don't want that. So if you want to disable it or remove it totally, you can go here in user startup sequence and disable it. To disable a line, you just need to add the semicolon at the start of the line, and this is disabled. With UI, it is possibly better to use normal PAL, though you then get larger pointers. Yeah, you see, Bowman, here the pointer for the text, it's huge. Is this the new included editor? Looks nice. Yeah, that's a text edit. It has tabs on every application that you, for every file that you open, and it has color syntaxing, as you can see, based on the file type. So you can set for different file types, totally different color syntaxing and indentation, and to show the line numbers and things like that. And that's something that you can set from the file type options here. So if I want for this file type, which is the shell scripts, if I want to add different type of indentation, for example, to have tab characters instead of spaces, or to add here to show the line numbers. If I click OK here, you can see that line numbers were added, and that's pretty useful. So now that we installed AmigaSSL, let me do a reboot again. Yeah, Camilla Bowman is the developer of this text edit, and she did a tremendous job, well done. And she's of course in the chat, and I'm really happy that she's here. So now that we have AmigaSSL, which is necessary for most of the websites, we can install iBrowse, the latest version of iBrowse, which I have here. And I believe that for such a machine is the best choice, the best browser to use. So if I do LHAX iBrowse here, what problem does the MIUI ASL patch causes? Not a problem at all. Just some people don't like it. It's just like that. Or they they prefer the ASL that comes with the requester that comes with the system. And also have in mind that the patched ASL that comes with Magic User Interface, it uses Magic User Interface. So some depending on the machine that you are using, it might be a little bit slower. So we have the iBrowse here. Let's install it. I think iBrowse uses Class Act. No, it uses Magic User Interface. If so, will the bundled reaction handle the dependencies? The AWeb uses Class Act, and it works fine. I used that for a while. iBrowse is Magic User Interface. Right. On OS 4 is a completely new ASL, says C2. C277, welcome to the stream. Amiga gamers, no worries, man. AWeb, it is pretty good, but unfortunately the development of that browser stopped a long time ago. So in my opinion, iBrowse that is still maintained, it's a much better solution for browsing with your Amiga. So I'm going to install iBrowse, and guess where? Going to install, no, it doesn't work. System, it would be nice if we could drag and drop a folder inside the installer, but some other time. A drawer named iBrowse will be created, right. So we are fine. English built-in, that's good. No. 60, 020, 030, that's right. There is a newer version of AWeb for AmigaOS 4 which supports SSL. The 68K version doesn't support SSL websites. So even if you install it, most of the websites are not going to work because of the lack of the SSL. iBrowse uses AMI SSL, of course, so it has access to all the websites. Although that the look of the website might not be the best, but it does the job. So iBrowse installer asks us to install some Magic User Interface libraries, so we say yes. They will now be installed. Okay, proceed. End list, we don't have that, that's fine. End list view, that's good. End list views, okay. End flow text, end list tree. Install all of them because we have a brand new installation, so we don't have these libraries. The Cache Explorer in iBrowse 2.5.4 uses a few custom new, okay. Install this as well, and we are almost done. Installation complete. So right now, if I open the iBrowse, most probably it will not work because I don't remember if I have the BSD socket library enabled. I think I don't. Sigurborn says that it has an Icelandic translation by me though, so it's obviously better. It's not better. The iBrowse, if you did that translation, congrats. It's a big locale file for iBrowse. Let's see if it works, but I doubt. Yeah, so let me quit this emulator and enable the PSD socket, and now if we boot it will be fine. We are going to be online. Bowman says Chris Young's net surf uses reaction and he sounds like he might take a look at optimizing for 3.2. That would be great. Although that I had a lot of issues with the reaction version of NetSurf. The SDL version worked much better for me. I don't know about you guys. What do you think? But I had a lot of... I had a hard time to make it even load any page. GDPR required pretty much any European-based website to move to SSL. Let me tell you my opinion on that. That if Google didn't value more the websites that have HTTPS available, I don't believe that people would move to SSL just because of the GDPR. Although I'm not sure that GDPR requires the SSL, to be honest, because it has to do with the information that you store on your databases, on your website, and not how you get or you do the exchange of that information. But I might be wrong. AmigaWorld.net still works on iBrowse though, and I will try to make sure any CMS move will keep it Amiga compatible. That will be awesome. Awesome. Yeah, AmigaWorld.net works very nice in iBrowse, and yeah, let's see it. Amiga Gamer 1200 says, but yeah, but they all spy on you anyway in a more secure manner. iBrowse is still in development. There was stated 2021. Yeah, Pretesta, the iBrowse is still in development. And actually the latest version was released, what? Enable. Or compatible network interface. Maybe I did something wrong. Okay. Ah, yeah. Stupid me. I will do it like Amiga Bill. Silly George. You are required to use SSL. Yeah, okay. I might be wrong. There is a clear requirement that any user information, including username and password, cannot be sent in clear text. That's right. Okay. Yes, iBrowse is still being developed, says N. Pagonis. You're right, George. It was Google. If you wanted to appear, SSL was the only way. Yeah, because Google did penalty points to website that didn't have SSL. SSL is obviously a lot slower for an Amiga browser. To be honest, yeah, because not for the browser, but for the CPU. And to be honest, on my 1200 with a 68030 that runs on 50 megahertz, and I'm using a PCMCIA Wi-Fi card to connect to internet, which also gets some CPU cycles, it goes very well. It goes very well. Of course, you have to disable JavaScript totally. And thank God all our websites are working without JavaScript at all, because that's one of the biggest pains for all the browsers out there, the JavaScript. So if we go to AmigaWorld.net, now it should work just fine. SSL is obviously a lot slower for an Amiga browser, yeah? Is it possible to buy, register it? Preceda, yeah, you can buy it. We can see the website in a minute. And you get all the updates free of charge, which is pretty good. And they release updates every 5-6 months. Yep. Yeah, let's see the you get a key, yeah. You can go to About Us and see a 15-year-old picture of me. Here in this website, in AmigaWorld.net, I was looking at the About Us, and it has some pretty nice information there, although that it needs a lot of update because it mentions pretty interesting things. Let it load first. Yeah, About Us. Thanks for the link. Let me do it here, like that. I would say that my Amiga is much faster than this emulated version. 90% of the staff have quit. You are the rest of 10%? Who is the owner of AmigaWorld.net right now? If you would like to share it with us. Amiga kit, okay. Nice. So there is a good and strong company behind the website, that's good. Amiga kit has also the Amiga.org, right? So those websites are pretty much sister websites. Probably because we are streaming, my connection is pretty slow, or because of the demo version of the iBrowse that uses only two connections. So it needs some patience. And then we will see after that the latest version of when the latest version of iBrowse was released. The present and future. AmigaWorld.net is currently one of the most popular Amiga sites on the internet today and regularly receives well over 3-4 million page views per month. Services over the AmigaWorld.net include Amiga News, discussion forums, regular sessions, regular QA sessions with Amiga Inc.'s CTO Flitzy Moss. Interesting. Pretty news. Internet radio, where's that? And buy and sell classifieds and much more. I think that About Us needs a little bit of update. This might be slow, says Amiga Gamer, but if it was running in Chromium, you'd be up to 64 gigabytes of RAM used by now. Yeah, possibly. Just because you opened Chromium, right? I worked with Flitzy, that was 15 years ago, and he wasn't part of Amiga. We used to do radio session on Fridays and Saturdays using Icecast. I remember those sessions, yeah, because I used to listen on them, but I miss them. Yeah, that's why I'm asking where they are. That's me, Sibi. Okay. Oh, nice. My first computer was a rubber keyboard Sinclair Spectrum ZX. I had a lot of fun playing classic like Psit, Jetpack and cookies that came with it. ZX Spectrum, eh? That's nice, nice machine. Although I'm more of a Commodore 64 child. I later got a Commodore 64, which was even more fun, and started my 25-year-long love affair with Commodore products. Nice, good work. And you are still here, that's the most interesting thing. So I browse. That's their website. I browse dashdev.net. Okay, and the latest version here was released 2nd of April 2021. I guess 2nd of April and not 1st of April so that we can get them serious, right? So it is pretty new. I browse dashdev.net. So we have our Amiga on the internet, and if we want, we can go to Aminet. To download whatever we need. But since we are on the internet, what else we could have? Recently, a new version of AmiRC was released, 3.8, for Morphos and 68K Amigas. I don't have it here right now to test it, but I would like to show you another application that I love to use on my Amiga, and that is called IMP, Infinite Module Player. I don't know if you know it. Execute, but it's pretty nice application. LHAX IMP. Okay. So, if I do here IMP, like that, do you know it? Do you know this application? What happened? I closed it. Register now, maybe later. Yeah, it just auto-updated itself. That's why it closed and opened again. So, IMP is a very interesting application. You can listen music of mods from Aminet and other sources. It downloads those files and starts playing them one by one. And if you donate for the application, it you are able to set specific modules as preferred or loved modules, and you can only listen to them, or you can listen to the most voted modules out there, and it's very nice application. Listen a little bit of music. We'll be right back. and you can have it also in Windows and separated Windows on the workbench if you want. One of the nice things that it has, but I think it doesn't work on the not registered version, that's like that, you have a chat here. This area is chat, and you can communicate with other people that are using IMP, and also you can propose them some modules that you like. If you want, you can share it with them. And also, if you open it on its own, you see here it downloads a big file. When you have a different, when you open IMP in a different screen, there is a way to have different themes, color themes, for this screen, which is pretty nice. So you find it in Aminet as imp.lh, and that's a very nice tool to use. So let's go and see visual preferences. New cell. Amiga Gamer 1200 says auto update legacy bug fixes and performance improvements. You mean for a specific application or something else? Aris Amiga says this sounds so good, right? It is. Preseda, Lemon Amiga, the fact that I like is I am searching where to buy Amiga products, not where to pirate them. Absolutely. That is what we all should do. Yeah, Empagonis, I totally agree. Yeah, I buy as much Amiga software as I can. Otherwise, we will not see anything else to be released, right? I even bought a new key file because I lost mine, and I now have a MUI that is registered to the AmiRC guy because Stans lost the ability to make new keys. Yeah, unfortunately, that's my key as well. I buy almost all new games, preferably boxed. If the box doesn't support Ortho, I buy additionally even digital downloads. That's good, Preseda. Very good. Always have. I had a lot of registered software. At some point, I realized to keep getting software I'd need to support the developers, probably too little, too late, though. Why do you say that, Sigurbord? It's never too late. It's never too late. And that's why we see new releases come out almost every month. We have so many new things to play with. And that's very good. Let's see the visual prefs. And that's very good because it keeps this community and this platform alive, right? And that's what we need. And that's what makes Amiga so different from any other platform. I think the Amiga community is becoming more and more alive again. Yeah, totally. Thanks to people like you, Bowman, who are working their ass off to bring us so many interesting things. Let's see where we are going to install visual prefs. It's not installed. A drawer will not be created. That's a good thing to know. So I'm going to install it. Where? I'm going to install it on show drives system. I will say in what do you say? We are definitely not done with improving the OS. That's what we need to hear, Bowman. that you are not done, that you have so many things to bring us. Yes, and that is so exciting thanks to all the devs who keep us happy. Exactly, Pagonis. That's good that we have them. And the least that we could do is to support them and embrace them to do more. Otherwise, we are going to sit back and play video games on our Amiga, and that's all. Love the work on 3.1.4 and 3.2. It's definitely... Who would expect after so many years that we are going to get all this stuff for these machines? And we are here to discuss about it. Right? So I believe we are so lucky to be here and play with new versions of our beloved Amiga. Nobody was expecting it, right? Particularly love that reaction is back. Yeah, totally. I notice much interest in expansions from Terrible Fires to cheap Raspberry Pi accelerators. I wonder if this will drive more development of higher spec games, apps, now accelerators and fast emulation is so accessible. Totally. Only Amiga, yeah, Chitu. Spoke to Chris Aldi, hadn't heard from him in ages. He was happy to get paid. Mm. Yeah, but I hope all these new accelerators and all this new hardware to bring a little bit the prices down, because although that we have all this plethora of choices, we see the prices go up. So that more people can get their hands on these interesting things and play with their Amigas on a fast machine as well, right? Copy the documentation over there. Let's select O20. Do you want to install the Select Gadget class? Select it is needed for the cycle gadget pop-up feature to work. I guess that we will need to install it, but let me check here on devs. Oh no, no, my mistake. Should go to classes. Gadgets and see what we have here. Do we have a same named gadget? Select gadget. We don't. So I guess we are fine to go and install it. So I will say yes. Classes gadgets, just right. Italiano, I don't speak Italian right now. Glow icons. Example preference. Yeah, why not? Install example bitmaps, of course. Let's install them in the default. Install the patchwork bench program. It fixes a bug in iPrefs. I will say no. I will say no, don't install it, and we will see if we need it and bring it later. Let me check the chat. That is so true, George. Our hobby is getting so expensive. Erpagonis, you are right. Sigurborn says, yeah, we need some fresh hardware. Make a Cyclone V based Amiga based on the D10 board. Yeah, you're right. Although that is pretty immature yet, the solutions that they propose with PyStorm and the Raspberry Pi, I find it pretty interesting, because I just think that after 1 year or two, New versions of and more powerful hardware from Raspberry Pi is going to be released. So by changing the Raspberry Pi, you are going to have even more faster and more powerful Amiga. Of course, what they do right now with the Pi Storm has to be updated to support the newer versions of Raspberry Pi. But I see that this is going to be a simple and a cheap way to upgrade your machine that is going to give to so many people new possibilities. If you are using the full palette patch, you should make sure your FP prefs program is at least version okay. You can find FP prefs okay. We are not using that. If you are using other programs similar to Visual Prefs, no, we don't use it. You should uninstall them now. Good to know. Failure to do so could result in system crashes due to conflicts between equivalent patches. Okay. If you are using MCP, please turn off its sys-hi hack. Okay, we don't have anything like that right now. This is the release 1.5K, okay. Will be available next time you boot. Great. And the installation is in the folder that we specified. So here we are going to find a folder, Visual Prefs. Great. So let's go and do the update with the latest version of Visual Prefs. XVP, this one, to RAM, and see what we need to do. Great, let's see the README, and it says this is a maintenance update to Visual Preference 1.5K, whose main purpose is to make the program compatible with the new AmigaOS 3.2. That's because the 1.5K release wasn't quite get along with all the changes Intuition underwent in version 47, which was to be expected since Visual Prefs is a hack. So the developer of this hack says us to update. Let me see installation. Just rename. Come on, stop. Okay. Just rename the Visual Prefs and GUI executables best suited for the CPU of your Amiga and copy them over the existing versions and then reboot. Right. So if we do here a rename and I press write Amiga and R and I do that a GUI and here this one. Okay. And if I open. Come on, this one here. Okay. Are these files in this folder? No. Where are they? Are they in C? Let me see. There. No, I don't see them. So let's use find. With the exact Visual Prefs on sys is the same partition that you booted your Amiga. Okay, no matter how you named it. If you do sys on every file requester, it is the partition that you booted your machine. Ah, so it is system. So it is here. Okay. And the replace, right? And the GUI, maybe it is in preferences. Yeah, it is in preferences. So we copy that here. Replace and the icon. Awesome. And let me do the auto range icons. Nice. And let me reboot. Yes, the Raspberry Pi root is also fine. I like the FPGA implementations though. They fail very smooth. Sigurborn says that. Auto range is like a dream come true. Yeah. Auto range is pretty nice. And what I find even more interesting is that you can go and change it the way that you want. For example, on my Amiga, I do a sort by the type, so all the folders are going first, and then I do the arrangement and the save. So on the first run, we lost the menu. We don't see anything here, but it might be something. Oh yeah, because the visual prefs. Let's work on that. GUI. And doesn't look pretty good. Okay, I'm clicking in the wherever right now. Okay, so let's see what we did here. If I'm not wrong, it doesn't add anything in Workbench startup. Does it? No. Probably in default seems a little off. Totally. To be honest, I haven't tested that because I wanted to do all the installation with you here. So yeah, let me play a little bit with. Nice, we don't see anything. Okay, what we are going to do? We are going to reboot and try to go with no startup sequence. Yeah, probably it tries to load something. Maybe it is because I didn't install the patch, but we can see it and fix it. We can find the solution. Okay. Do we have it? ED. We do. Open. Okay. S. User startup. Actually, one of the reasons that I wanted to do these streams is also to see ways how to overcome issues. So this is a very good opportunity. Give me a sec because someone is on the door. I will be back in a minute. Hello, I'm back. So Yeah, let's see. L system startup, okay, exec. I'm looking the startup sequence right now to see where the visual preferences put itself. Here, so we can mark it and save, okay, and do a reboot. Snoop Dogg should be an internal part of OS 3.3. Snoop Dogg, yeah, it's one of the essential utilities. I like it a lot and I use it whenever I have issues, but this time we didn't need to use it. I guess that if we go and create a configuration, a default configuration for visual prefs, then if we enable it again, we will not have any issues. So let me see if I have, if there is any presets we could use. Okay. Double bright edges, only use half sign for bright, okay. Use half sign, symbol edges, teeth there for ground. First of all, it has about, okay. So we have the latest version, it works okay. I read in the patch notes their new ROM options in early startup for debugging startup sequences. Exactly, Amiga Gamer, there are. If you want, I can show you in a reboot these choices. Yeah. Snoop Dogg is essential. If you, yeah, because those options for the startup sequence are useful for when you have issues with your startup of the operating system, the AmigaOS. So if you have issues with that, these choices in the ROM are pretty useful to find where exactly you have those issues. But I don't think that they are useful whenever you have you have issues with a specific program. So Snoop Dogg is even good for that thing. Probably hard to get the two button mouse click on boot in FSUI. Actually, not really, but we can see it. In FSUI, it works just fine. The double button click. Hard enough on a real Amiga. Maybe. Make square title bar gadgets. Okay. So let me remember how this is used. Anyone? Any help? System. Okay. Nice. What I'm going to do is just save it like it is, so it will create this one, for example, save it, so it will create the default configuration files, and let me go and install the text, and enable again the visual prefs on startup sequence. And if that doesn't work, then I will spend some time to find what exactly is the problem, and we will discuss it on the next stream. So let me do a reboot. There is one preset on the first menu. Okay, we will see it. One preset. It will be interesting to find a preset that is using the same look and feel. It's a good thing that we have the title. The same use look and feel with AmigaOS 4. So I will look about that. Nice, it works. So you see, it needed the default configuration, actually, the default preferences, and then it works fine. So if I go, you mean, Chitu, you mean the preset open here, maybe? Backdrops, I don't see any presets. GUI sample pre, I think. That's the one. File contains only one screen definition. Do you want to add it to the current list? To apply to the current screen or to replace the current list with it? Replace. Okay. Use. Nice. So if we go. No, I think that you can change the color of the titles, of the font of the titles, right? Not this one. Anyway, but it works fine, I guess. And I guess that if we want to have a better gadgets here, we can go to the icon roll and change the appearance to this one and add some window space, save, and we can get no, with visual prefs this is not possible because I guess we have some. Okay, let's open the open global edit, reset to defaults. Okay, save defaults. So it seems that visual prefs overrides the height of the window title bar, because if we remove it, you will see, let me show you that. Yeah, I remember that the visual prefs has a way to make this bigger, right? Sizing gadget height. No, that's for the bottom one. Okay, arrow gadgets. Okay, border size, title bar height, exactly. That's for the screen. We need for the window here. Okay, that's one way to do it. Of course, with visual prefs, but if you don't have visual prefs and you don't want to use anything else from visual prefs, you can do exactly the same thing from the eye control here that is included in AmigaOS 3.2 from these things, from this preferences window. Okay. But we might want to use visual prefs just to skin the window borders and things like that. So I will say that's all for today. We can see more things on the next stream. Tell me what do you think, if you find this kind of streams interesting, and if you would like to see more of these streams for the future. And if you want, send me also a message what you would like to see to install on the AmigaOS 3.2, And if you want specific things to test and whatever you want, we can do it. Sigurborn. Yeah, the Visual Prefs has so many options because it is one of the oldest and very useful hacks to change the way that the windows are displayed. It's very good. You will see on the next streams that I will find the presets that make it look more like AmigaOS 4, maybe. Actually, the AmiKit X, and it uses Visual Prefs as well for the skinning, and it has a lot of nice skins there. Thanks, Npagonis. It's very, very nice of you. Thanks, Chitu. Thank you. Yes, also go through tools and utilities in depth one by one. You mean, Preceta, you mean the tools and utilities that come with AmigaOS or different utilities that we can find from Aminet or any other source? I think just exploring and building a handmade complete OS would be a nice way to continue. Thank you, Amiga Gamer, that you were here. Thank you all for the for joining this stream. You helped me a lot to keep on doing that. We can see if you want the tools and the utilities that come with AmigaOS 3.2, if you want. And then see whatever else we need to add there. I left the live video in the background, but nice stream. Thank you very much, SLD. You are very kind. So, built-in tools and utilities. That's good. We are going to do it. But before we leave, I promised you to have a look on the ROM extra choices, right? So let me quit this machine and get the kickstart that comes with AmigaOS 3.2 and boot with that and keep the double mouse buttons pressed so we can see it. Right. First of all, you see that here is mentioned the Kickstart number, the Kickstart version, and that options, you see the new boot options that there are. For example, before we had the disabled CPU caches and that's exactly the same thing. Now we have choices like update ROM modules. This is enabled when you have Kickstart 3.1 or 3.14. And then we have failsafe boot, trace startup sequence, and enable system log. Failsafe boot is something like the safe boot that Windows have. It boots on AmigaOS in a way that things like the user startup are not loaded. Okay, actually it has a separate startup sequence. We can see it if you want, that describes exactly what it will, the Amiga will do when it boots on failsafe boot. Trace startup sequence boots with a basic startup sequence and shows line by line what it loads and what it does exactly in the startup sequence. And I think that it requires also your input to continue or not. And enable system log, what it does, it instead of the output of the startup sequence to go to the serial, any output messages and things like that, they are all saved in the RAM in a file, so you can access that later in cases that you don't have a separate machine to grab that serial log and see what is happening there. You can do that and get this system log in the RAM
machine. So if in the RAM, in the RAM as a file. So let's boot at with the failsafe. Can failsafe startup sequence be altered? If so, it can cause quite dangerous situations. One of the things that I like in Amiga is the freedom it gives you. So this is good, in my opinion, that you can alter it. So if you go to the S folder and see the files, there is this startup failsafe. Let me open. No. Open this one, right? And here you can see exactly what it does. It avoids to patch ROM, and all the necessary information is here. But yeah, if you don't want to mess with your machine a lot, try not to edit this file, because it is there in case something happens. But on the other hand, if you do have pretty serious problems, you can boot with your module disk. If you have, for example, an Amiga 1200, you can use the module disk for this machine and boot with that and have a simple environment to work with and fix any issues. Unless it is issues with the file system, which if it is a fast file system, you can use this Doctor Disk to boot and fix those issues as well. Startup failsafe is actually bigger than proper startup sequence. Yep, maybe. Yeah, you're absolutely right. I haven't seen that. You are absolutely right. I guess that's because, not of the commands, but the comments at the top, possible. And with big letters, don't touch this file. It may be overwritten without warning. Yeah, I guess in future updates. Mostly the comments at the top, yeah. Exactly, Amiga Gamer. And also there is this startup sequence. Okay. Shell startup, which you can use to set some things when you start the shell, what it should do. For example, here it sets some aliases. So if you do write xcopy, it will do something like copy clone. If you decide in infinite wisdom to change this file, they know their user base. Exactly. You are right, Sigurborn. And the shell startup sequence is. The shell startup is pretty good to have a look. So, guys, thank you very much for being here. You helped me a lot with these streams, because I'm not a streamer. I try my best to give you information for the AmigaOS. I hope you find it interesting, and have a good day and a tremendous and great weekend, and see you next week. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.